Open Forum today. 2 hours of Open Forum, as a matter of fact, with two very fine guests. Second hour, we expect Mark Brumley with us from Ignatius Press. And this hour, Jimmy Akin, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, and the proud papa of a beautiful brand new book that has its own website, by the way. I found out your book has its own website. The Bible is a Catholic. The Bible is a CatholicBook.com.
Yeah,
all one word. Mm-hmm. Hello, Jimmy Akin.
Hello, Cy Kellett.
Congratulations again on the book. I hope that it's getting a great reception.
Yeah, I've already having a lot of radio shows and podcasts asking me on to talk about it. I did a couple of them today, so.
So a lot of time in front of a microphone,
yes,
letting people know the book is out.
Yeah.
For those of you who are not unaware of what Open Forum means here, it means that if you have a question about the Catholic faith, you got a question about the Bible or the saints, you got a question about religion or morality more generally, the phone lines are open to you. And they're also open whether you're Catholic or not. 888-318-7884 is the number, but I'll give you a little warning because that's the first time I gave out the number, and already there's only one line left open. All other lines are full. So it does get busy, especially when Jimmy is here with us. So go ahead and dial 888-318-7884 if you have a question. We'll be talking a little bit more, I'm sure, throughout the show about Jimmy's brand new book, The Bible is a Catholic Book. But if you got a question about that, go ahead and dial 888-31-TRUTH. Or, as I said, about anything else. Because the lines filled up immediately, I feel like we should just go to calls. But
That's fine with me.
All right, let's go to John in San Antonio, Texas. You are first up today, John. Your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hello. Yes, I had a question. It's about different types of suffering. Whether you could tell whether it's from God's plan as a sacrifice within his plan, or whether it would be coming from a demonic source or a part of spiritual warfare.
Okay, so all suffering is part of God's plan in the sense that he at least allows it. So it's part of his permissive will. And that means that he's going to bring good out of it. And so to the extent that we're able to, we want to cooperate with his plan of bringing good out of whatever evil is present in life. And there are different ways this happens. Just on the natural level, you know, we have pain receptors in our skin, and that those cause suffering if we come into contact, you know, with something that's dangerous. Like if you put your hand on a hot stove, your pain receptors are going to fire, and it's real easy to see how God's brings good out of that. It gets you to move your hand away from the fire so you don't sustain bodily damage. We also have the ability to experience mental, emotional suffering, and in some cases it's easy to see how good comes out of that. For example, if you're afraid you might lose your job, then that motivates you to work harder so that you don't lose your job. And so in some of these cases, it's pretty obvious what the suffering is telling us, and we want to do what we can then to bring good out of it, like moving your hand away from the stove or working harder so you don't lose your job or whatever it may be. In other cases, the reason that the suffering is present is not as clear. But it could be a number of things. The Bible talks about the sources of evil in the world being the world, the flesh, and the devil. And so if we think about those sources of evil as sources of suffering, well, sometimes it is going to be the devil that's causing suffering or one of his agents. And the only real way to be confident of that, because the devil is just one of the three sources, the only way to be confident of that is if there's something overtly demonic happening. You know, like if you have a person who's possessed and manifesting signs of possession, and they're talking like a demon and stuff like that. Well, in that case, you could say, okay, there's definitely demonic activity here. But although even that you have to judge prudently. But if you don't have something clearly demonic happening, then you don't want to too quickly assume it's a demonic attack. You should look instead to the idea, okay, maybe this is the world. It's just someone out, something out there in the world that's causing this. It's not related to the devil specifically. Or maybe it's something in my own brokenness as a human being, in the flesh, so to speak, that's causing the suffering. Regardless of whether the suffering is caused by the world, the flesh, or the devil, we want to do our best to bring good out of it. In some cases, if there's no obvious way to bring good, like taking your hand away from the stove or going to a doctor to get treatment, the what we may do is pray and offer it up, regardless of the source of the suffering. We can still offer it up for our sanctification and for the good of the world. We can ask God, if I'm pleasing you in how I deal with this suffering, and please help me deal with the suffering, but also if I'm pleasing you in dealing with it, please help me and other people. It also can be an occasion to reflect on why is this suffering happened. Maybe there's something I can learn here. And that can even include learning virtues like patience and being able to not freak out when we encounter suffering, but to relax and trust God and know that it's not going to last forever. So those are some basic thoughts that I would have on dealing with suffering. One thing I would also mention, though, is to the extent we have the ability to relieve suffering, we want to do that. We don't want to say to ourselves, I'm suffering, so it must be God's will that I keep suffering.
Oh, yeah.
If I'm suffering at the moment, well, it's his will to allow me to have this suffering for whatever reason, but that doesn't mean he wills I keep on suffering.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave us the power to alleviate suffering in many cases, both for other people and for ourselves, and he expects us to use that. He doesn't expect us to just say, oh, I'm suffering, so I need to stay this way. We want to do things like go to the doctor or go to a counselor or change our behavior so that we don't suffer in the same way, and that's part of God's plan too.
John, I hope that that was helpful to you. Thank you so much for starting us off today with Open Forum. If you'd like to ask Jimmy a question, 888-318-7884 is our number. Again, just one line open now, 888-318-7884. Dago in Tampa, Florida, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. I don't know. Did I pronounce it right, or how close did I get?
Hey, you actually got it right. Sorry.
Okay. Good. Yeah. Dago, your question for Jimmy.
All right. Good evening to you guys. Well, Jimmy, I just wanted to ask, in James chapter 5, verse 15, he mentions the prayer of faith, and if I'm certain, this is regards to the anointing of the sick. And I just wanted to ask, do we traditionally know what the prayer of faith is verbatim or have an idea, or is that left open to the...
It's not a specific prayer. The prayer of faith is a kind of, this is one of the instances where a more literal translation like the Revised Standard Version kind of trips us up a little bit, because saying the prayer of faith in Greek just means the faithful prayer, or a prayer offered in faith, or something like that. And in fact, you'll see other more dynamic translations translated a little bit differently. Like in the New International Version, it says the prayer offered in faith. And that's really what's meant. The idea is that by offering this prayer, the ministers of the church are expressing faith in God through this prayer, and God will respond to their faith by responding to their prayer. It's not a specific prayer that has a set form of words that James is expecting the elders of the church to use in this passage.
Okay.
All right.
And well, I had a follow-up question.
Yeah.
Follow-up question too. Is the anointing of the sick, is that limited to clergymen or deacons and priests, or is that any layperson can, in circumstances, take place?
It's, well, obviously any layman can pray
for another person to be healed. But in terms of the sacrament, this is something that's reserved to priests. The term that James uses in, like, the New International Version, it'll say the elders of the church, let him call for the elders of the church. And the word there in Greek is presbyteroi, which we bring across into English as priest. And the fact that this is limited to priests, so deacons can't do this, only priests, and that would include bishops. But the fact only priests can do this was actually infallibly defined by the Council of Trent. So that's something we know for sure.
Dago, thank you very, very much. I hope that was helpful to you. I want to stress again that Jimmy's book is out. The Bible is a Catholic book. We've got it in our warehouse. You can get an ebook version of it. We can send you an individual copy if you order it. Or you can even get this in bulk for just $3 a copy. When you order in bulk, it's just $3 a copy. You can share it with family, friends, maybe the people in your parish or your Bible study group. It's just perfect for all those situations. You can get all the information you want on The Bible is a Catholic Book just by going to the brand new website, thebibleisacatholicbook.com. And I don't know, were you aware of this, Jimmy? There's a sample chapter there.
I did not know that, but yeah, that's great.
There's a sample chapter, and then they've got your cool new video there. You can get all that at thebibleisacatholicbook.com. But if you've already made up your mind, you know you want it, you can just head over to shop.catholic.com and get your copy right now. The Bible is a Catholic Book by Jimmy Akin.
Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live is proudly supported by CatholicChemistry.com, a new dating site for Catholics who want to do dating right and believe relationships start with Catholic chemistry. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicChemistry.com for their generous support on the web at CatholicChemistry.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
I'm really a revert. There are a lot of converts on Catholic radio, a lot of reverts, those who have come back to the faith. And ever since I came back to a practice of my faith, I started praying the rosary, going to even daily mass, God has led me on an amazing journey and used me in a lot of incredible ways that I never dreamed would have been possible.
Take Two with Jerry and Debbie, tonight, midnight Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and it's 2 hours of open forum today. Mark Brumley will be with us the second hour. You know Mark. He's the president of Ignatius Press. This hour, Jimmy Akin, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers and author of the brand new book, The Bible is a Catholic Book, is our guest. Any question you've got for Jimmy is welcome. If you have just a moral question or a more generally religious question, those are welcome in addition to questions about the Catholic faith or Christian people. 888-318-7.
Or lots of other stuff.
884. I don't want to encourage them asking about space aliens and stuff like that because they will do it.
The homeworlds of the Legion of Superheroes?
You know, okay, all right. That, of course, they could call and ask about.
So where would you guess Saturn Girl is from?
I am going to go with Saturn.
Technically, the moon of Saturn, Titan.
Oh, yeah. That's one of my top 10 favorite moons of Saturn.
Biggest moon in the solar system.
Is it really bigger than our moon?
Yes, yeah. And it's very rich in petroleum.
Really?
Yeah, lots of hydrocarbons on Saturn.
Well, we got to get there first.
It's Space Texas.
Space Texas, yeah. I did want to tell you one thing.
What's that?
I don't want to tell you who it was, but a very kind of famous and well-known Catholic editor said to me, this is a really well-written book. Jimmy has become a very, very fine writer.
Oh, so thank you.
Yeah.
To whoever said that.
Yeah.
And to you for letting me know.
He's on next hour, but I don't want to name who it is. Nate in Dallas, Texas, you are up next. Nate's watching on YouTube Live. Nate, your question for Jimmy.
Hey, gentlemen. Good afternoon. Hope you don't mind me saying hey to Karen McMunn on the YouTube chat. My question is, I'm sure that you've heard non-believers say, can God lift make a rock so heavy that he can't lift it? Mm-hmm. And the rebuttal to that, as I understand it, is no, that's a logical impossibility. That's logically contradictory. You can't
Well, that's one rebuttal to it.
Yes. So, the main one.
Yeah. So regarding that main one, my question is to Jimmy that are certain things in the Christian faith logical contradictions, such as the Trinity, that seems logically impossible, fully man and fully human.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, fully man and fully God. That mm-hmm. seems also as impossible as a stone so heavy that he can't lift it. Other things might be the real presence or the full body of Jesus present in every Eucharist and every crumb that falls off, his full body fully present in all. So,
okay, so we've got about four different issues on the table there. The general answer that connects all of them is no, none of those involve logical contradictions. That doesn't mean that they're easy for humans to understand. Humans have finite minds, and that means we're limited in our ability to fully grasp certain things. So we see this with other species. Like sometimes if you have a canary and you put a mirror in the cage with the canary, it will think it's another bird.
Uh-huh.
And it'll even look around behind the mirror looking for the other bird because it doesn't understand this is its own reflection. But with the broader human perspective, we understand that. We understand, no, there's not this magical bird that's appearing and disappearing when you, depending on which side of the mirror your head is on.
All right.
When God reveals, God is therefore infinitely above us. You know, being all-knowing, he's way smarter than we are. He's unlimitedly knowing. And that means that he's aware of many things that transcend human reason. Some of them are probably things that we're like the bird. We can't grasp it at all.
Yeah.
But other things are kind of on the fringe of what we can understand, where we can understand part of the truth, but not all of the truth. And things like the Trinity and the real presence are like that. We can understand them enough to realize that there's not a logical contradiction here. What a logical contradiction is where the very terms that are involved in saying something imply a contradiction, like in the phrase, a square circle. Well, no shape can have a square, can have a perimeter that is simultaneously square and simultaneously circular. Similarly, the phrase four-sided triangle. No, a triangle can't have four sides because a triangle has three sides by definition. It also has three angles, which is why they're called triangles, not tricidals.
Yeah.
In those cases, we can see there is a logical contradiction involved. But with these other things you've mentioned, there is not. There is no logical contradiction. In the case of the Trinity, the claim is God is one being who is three persons. And I actually talk about this in my book, A Daily Defense, since we've got several items on the table. I won't go through it in detail. But the category of being is different than the category of person. And so you can have some beings, things that exist, that's what a being is. You can have some beings like a rock that are zero persons, and you can have some beings that are one person, like you and me. We're human beings and we're each one person. And so we can see that the number in each category doesn't match up. If you can have some beings that are zero persons and you have some beings that are one person, then you can have some beings that are more than one person. And that happens to be what God is. Similarly, in terms of saying Jesus is fully God and fully man, the adjective fully can be a little misleading in ordinary speech, because when we say something is fully, we sometimes mean it's all this and nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
Like if I say this glass is fully filled with water, well, then it's all filled up with water and there's no room for anything else. That's not how we're using fully when we say Jesus is fully God and fully man. He's not fully God and nothing else, he's not fully man and nothing else. When we use fully in this context, we mean his human nature is complete. Mm-hmm. He's fully human in that sense. He's not missing anything from his human nature.
Right.
And when we say he's fully God, we mean his divine nature is fully complete. He's fully divine. He's not missing anything from his divine nature. And so he actually has these two natures. And when we say he's fully God and fully man, we just mean he has a complete one of each, a complete divine nature, a complete human nature. In terms of the real presence, again, there's no logical contradiction there. I don't really have time to fully unpack that one. But again, a careful study of the terms involved will reveal there is no logical contradiction. Also, we have these kind of surprises when we're dealing with God is actually what we'd expect. Because you look at other things in God's created world, like, say, quantum mechanics.
Yeah.
Lots of unexpected surprises that are counterintuitive in how the world works on the fundamental level. Our minds are designed to work on a certain level, to interact with phenomena that commonly affect humans. So we understand things that are big enough for us to see, but not things that are too small for us to see or vastly bigger than we can comprehend. Well, God is vastly above us, and so if we're dealing with someone vastly above us, we would expect some of the things they tell us to be a little strange from our perspective.
Yeah, fair enough. Nate, we'd love it when you call. I don't know if you know, Nate follows us on YouTube.
Yeah.
Kind of a well-known skeptic over there, and thanks for the opportunity to address your questions when you have them. Nate, call.
Always happy to, and if you want like more detail on the real presence and how that works, you know, in terms of the logical structure of it, call again. I'd be happy to help.
Up next is Jerry in Vancouver, Canada, also watching on YouTube Live. Jerry, delighted to have you. Your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Si. Hi, Jimmy.
Hi, Jerry.
I have the Revised Standard Version Catholic Edition, and I complement it with the Dorian Rheims, but I'm looking for the corrected translation of the New American Bible that's used in the liturgy. Mm-hmm. And I know that the NAB that's used in the liturgy is the one that has fixes done by the Vatican, like Luke 1:28. My question is, how did the U.S. bishops approve of the NAB when it had mistranslation in these critical verses? And I know that the RSVC isn't entirely correct, but it's better. But and also, I want to get my hands on the fixed NAB version, but I'm not sure if it's even out there. That's it.
Okay, so let's talk about the last question first. There is not, as far as I'm aware, an edition of the, you said the New American Bible that's as used as liturgy, in the liturgy, is the one you want?
Mass, yeah.
Okay, I'm not aware of any edition of that that's been published other than the lectionary itself. So if you want to read that translation, you want to get a lectionary. In terms of how the process happened that the United States bishops approved a translation that the Vatican insisted on modifications on, well, no, as you mentioned, the RSV also contains mistakes. No Bible translation is perfect for two reasons. One, no language maps onto another language exactly. There are always differences in grammar and meaning that you can't represent in any simple way. For example, if I said the word kitty, mm-hmm. How would you say that in Spanish?
Gatito.
Gatito, right. That would be a good guess. It would mean a little cat in Spanish, from gato.
Right.
Well, so that's a good translation, assuming that by kitty I meant a small cat.
Ah.
But what if I meant a pool of money on a poker table?
I don't know that word in Spanish.
Yeah, and because it's probably not gatito.
No, yeah, right. And that would be a great coincidence, right?
And what that shows us is that the single English word kitty can mean more than one thing in Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't just represent English to Spanish in a one-to-one way. There are always going to be things that you have to adjust. And also, second reason no translation is perfect, no Bible translators are perfect. Not only do they have to make choices in terms of how are we going to try to approximate this meaning in our own language, they're not always going to get those choices right. And so the standard that's used when evaluating a Bible translation is not, is it perfect? It's, is it good enough? And the U.S. bishops, when they approved the electionary based on the New American Bible, on certain editions of it, they said, okay, it's good enough for use in the liturgy. Not saying it's perfect, just that it's good enough. And the Vatican said, not quite good enough. We want to make a few additional changes just so that when this gets read out loud, people will hear certain things. But even the Vatican wasn't expecting the lectionary to be perfect, just good enough for use at Mass. So that's a kind of a sketch of the general situation.
Jerry, we'll have to leave it there because, as you're about to hear, it is break time. It is open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, author of the brand new book, The Bible is a Catholic Book, is our guest this hour. If you have a question about the Catholic faith, let me see how many lines are open. One line open, 888-318-7884, the number. That means we got a lot of work to do as we continue. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" Turns out that today, as back then, this question has a lot of different answers. So many groups want to appropriate Jesus, tweaking his identity until he looks and sounds just like one of them. But then you no longer have the Lord, says apologist Trent Horn. You have an imposter. In his new groundbreaking book, Counterfeit Christ, Trent exposes 18 phony versions of Jesus that we encounter today, helping you to recognize the fakes when you see them, explain why they're phony, and make a case for the full truth and beauty of who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Order your copy of Counterfeit Christ today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Have you subscribed to the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter? This is Catholic Answers Live host Cy Kellett, and I want to tell you about our new weekly newsletter full of behind-the-scenes information and facts you need to know about the show. It's easy to sign up. Just visit CatholicAnswersLive.com and look for the newsletter sign-up box on the front of the page. It's a great way to keep up to date with what's happening with the show and see what's coming in the days ahead, delivered weekly into your inbox. Sign up today for the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter and see what you've been missing. Go to CatholicAnswersLive.com.
Wouldn't it be great to have a book to give to anyone to explain exactly why Catholics believe what we believe? Why We're Catholic is the groundbreaking book by apologist Trent Horn, that one book you can give to anyone as a starting point for helping them to find their way into or back to the practice of the Catholic faith. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic organizations are doing amazing things in this world. We want to hear your take on tomorrow's Take Two with Jerry and Debbie. Now let's get back to Cy Kellett and Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest. It's open forum. About a million people on the phone right now, so I want to make sure I move through them. We'll get to what's on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World this week in a little bit.
Oh, okay.
I have to do a little reading.
Okay. To prepare. Or you could just ask.
Yeah, I will. Okay, but I don't want to. Carolyn's been in Kentucky's been waiting a while. So Carolyn's listening to EWTN Channel 130 on Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Carolyn, your question for Jimmy.
Hello, gentlemen. My question is, how do you know when God wants you to do something? For example, I am dating a very nice Christian Catholic guy, and but he's kind in every way and wonderful, but I don't have any real romantic feeling for him. I'm not physically attracted to him that maybe I feel like I should. I don't have that excitement or feeling. It's more like a friendship. But mm-hmm. I know that he would be a good husband mm-hmm. and kind and wonderful and all of that. But aren't you supposed to have that kind of attraction? And the reason I'm asking this is I kind of promised God that I would give him a chance if God would help me out with something. And I feel like God kind of has. Mm. And now I don't want to go back on my promise. And
yeah. All right. Well, so Caroline, do I understand that you've called with this question before?
No, I did not.
Really? So there's apparently another woman named Caroline who is in exactly your situation, who has called four times, I understand. Well, I'm going to give you an answer, and I hope it helps. It's the same answer in basic terms you'd get from any competent apologist. Let's deal with so you won't be getting different answers if you call back again. They should all be in line with the one I'm about to give. In terms of the most general question, how do you know when God wants you to do something? Well, we can know it a few ways. We can know it when moral law tells us, or when divine revelation tells us, this is what God wants us to do. Like, God wants us to honor our parents, and he wants us to not kill people, and he wants us to be baptized. So we know those things by divine revelation. If we don't know by divine revelation, then we need to use reason to figure it out, which is God's other big gift to us. And so you want to, in an analyzing a course of action, you want to look at it in terms of what are the pros and cons. Assuming it's morally permitted, are there advantages to it? Are there disadvantages to it? How can I do the most good? And then you make your best guess and you trust God with the results. In terms of marrying somebody or pursuing any other vocation, it's important to realize that when God presents you with a particular vocation as a possibility, he's not mandating that you embrace this. If he offers someone a vocation to the priesthood or the religious life or the married life, he's not saying you have to do this and you're sinning if you don't. He's giving you an opportunity to do good in the world by being ordained or by being in a religious order or by being married. But it's an invitation, not a requirement. And so you shouldn't think of it in those terms. And so if the vocation to be married is itself an invitation rather than a requirement on God's part, the same thing is going to be true of who you marry, which is a subordinate question to the should I marry at all question. And so you, unless God gives you divine revelation, then in looking at a prospective marriage partner, you want to use reason. You want to get to know the person, so you learn about the person, so the person learns about you, and then you do a cost-benefit analysis and say, what are the advantages of this? What are the disadvantages of this? In terms of the attraction issue, you said, shouldn't we feel, you know, attraction to our spouse? Well, or a prospective spouse. Well, that's an ideal, but from the perspective of most people in human history, the answer is no. We in the West, in the last few hundred years, have had this ideal of romantic-based marriages where you're supposed to fall in love and then get married. Well, actually, in most cultures, first you get married and then you fall in love. And those romantic feelings, as anyone who's been married can tell you, they will come and go. They will not be there all the time. You will not always be feeling passion for someone. Younger people tend to experience that passion, especially in the beginning, but it's going to taper off. It'll come and go. It'll still be there, but it's going to taper off. And that means when it tapers off, you're going to need another foundation for being married to someone. And a really good foundation is friendship. If you're already friends with the person, that will help you have a successful marriage, even if the romantic feelings don't happen to be flaring up at the moment. So I can't tell you what to do in this situation. I don't know what's best for you in your situation, but those are some of the factors that I would bring to bear in figuring this out. So pray, trust God and do what you think is best.
Carolyn, thank you very, very much for the call. We go now to Josh in Columbia, Maryland, watching on YouTube. Is everybody on YouTube calling today? Josh, delighted to have you. Your question for Jimmy.
Oh, hey. So I visited this conservative SSP church once, and some of the things that the priest was saying seemed kind of off. Like, he said something like Vatican I was not an infallible council or something.
Vatican I or Vatican II?
I'm maybe confused because I thought the church council was supposed to be infallible or something.
Okay. So church councils, ecumenical councils, including Vatican I and Vatican II, have the potential to teach infallibly. They can teach infallibly, but that doesn't mean that they always are teaching infallibly. Some ecumenical councils, like Vatican I and like some of the Lateran councils centuries ago, they didn't teach anything infallibly. They were what are sometimes called pastoral councils. Even when a council does teach things infallibly, it's never all of what the council says. It'll be certain specific things that the council will teach infallibly, but then other things it teaches won't be infallible. An example of this would be the very first ecumenical council, the Council of Nicaea, which occurred in AD 325. It wrote the first draft of what's called the Nicene Creed, and that was infallible. That was something that is infallibly taught by the church. But Nicaea also went on to establish 20 canons. These are rules of church law that it also established, but those are rules. They're not infallible teachings. They're disciplinary measures saying this is how we're going to do this, at least right now. And like other laws, they can change because they're not infallible teachings. So every ecumenical council has the potential to teach infallibly, but they don't all use it. And even when they do, not everything the council says is going to be an infallible teaching, only certain things. If you'd like to learn about this, I have a book that actually deals with this very subject. It's called Teaching with Authority, and it deals with the different levels of church teaching, all the way up to things like infallible teachings and dogmas, but also everything else along the spectrum, and how to know which is which, and how to deal with difficulties when they arise. So that book is called Teaching with Authority.
Josh, you said you're new to Catholicism, so I just want to check back in with you. Is that helpful to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I was just confused. I'm technically not Catholic. Yeah, I'm about to start RCIA next week, actually.
So congratulations. That's awesome.
Well, in addition to sending you Jimmy's book, Teaching with Authority, I think we ought to send you Jimmy's newest book, The Bible is a Catholic Book. It'll be very helpful. I mean, it's helpful giving an insight into the Catholic faith and how Catholic people think, as well as into the Bible. So I'd love it if you'd have that in your hands. If you just hang on the line, Marie will get your information and we'll send you those. And also, if you have more questions, call again. Tuesdays and Thursdays are always open forum here on Catholic Answers Live. Josh, I'm going to try to take another question before I have to go to a break. So I will say thank you for that call. And we'll go to Francis, who's calling from Australia. Hello, Francis.
Hi, Jimmy. Thanks for taking my call.
No problem.
My question is, do the souls in purgatory and heaven, do they see us? Do they know what's going on in our lives?
They know at least certain things about us. We see evidence of that in Scripture because, for example, in the book of Revelation, and this is not the only place where this happens. Actually, we see this in the Old Testament too. But in the book of Revelation, we see the saints in heaven presenting to God the prayers of the saints on earth. So obviously, they know what we're praying.
Right.
And so they're aware of that. They're also aware of other things. And in the Old Testament, we similarly see saints in heaven praying for people who are on earth, and that indicates some level of awareness of what's happening on earth. The question that theologians have asked is, how do they know these things? How do they know about us? And it's possible that God could give them some kind of spiritual senses that let them know about things in the world, just like he gave us physical senses to let us know about it. But the most while that's possible, the actual common answer that theologians give is the way they know about us and what's happening with us is God himself tells them that if a piece of information is relevant to a saint in heaven, like someone wants you to pray for this, God lets them know that. And so God himself, because God knows everything, so it's just a question of does he choose to share it with someone? Yeah. And the general opinion among theologians is God will share with a saint whatever information is relevant to that saint and that the saint would, you know, want to know. In terms of the souls in purgatory, the situation is less clear, but it is commonly thought that the souls in purgatory are similarly aware of our prayer requests and that they can pray for us also.
Oh, okay, Francis.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much for that.
Yeah, no problem. I just want to clarify one thing since Francis is in Australia. If saints in heaven are aware of things on earth, even all the way in Australia.
Even like, all the way in Australia.
Even though it's really far. Okay.
And God cares for people in Australia too, you know? I mean,
I'm glad to hear
in
it.
Fact, he even inspired the creation of the podcast Catholics of Oz.
Oh.
So Francis might want to check out the podcast Catholics of Oz.
Okay, Francis.
Okay, I will. Thank you so much.
All right. God bless you, sister. We got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Prayer is a variety of forms of communication. Sometimes we simply greet one another, hi, how are you? And we say small, short prayers similarly to God. Other times we engage people in deep conversations. Other times we engage our families in family reunions and big meals. Similarly with God, we engage him in Eucharist and deep meditation as well.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin is our guest, and I've been mentioning his book, The Bible is a Catholic Book, and that brand new website, thebibleisacatholicbook.com, where you can watch videos from Jimmy, get some sample chapters. We've also got a brand new ebook called The Catholic Answers Guide to Navigating the Bible, and the way they did it, it begins and ends with excerpts from Jimmy Akin's book, The Bible is a Catholic Book, and it's got a lot of other good stuff in there as well. And you can get that free ebook just by going to the Catholic Answers Facebook page or to shop.catholic.com and look for the free ebook banner. And while you're on the internets, maybe visit thebibleisacatholicbook.com and get your copy there. Up next, Scott Nebraska is listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Scott, your question for Jimmy.
Hey, I've kind of got a big one here for you, Jimmy.
Okay.
I've been married for 7 years,
mm-hmm.
Been together for 12.
Mm-hmm.
My wife moved out probably 6 months ago.
Mm.
She's a convert.
Mm-hmm.
We've been to Retrovi. We did 2 weekends ago. It seemed to help us go. Helped a lot of the other couples. So if guys want to go, it's very helpful. Wish we would have 2 years ago. But she is not open to the idea of us ever being in a relationship again.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't believe the church is right when it comes to marriage is forever.
Mm-hmm.
I've listened to a lot of your shows about annulment. I'm only 36. I guess I don't know where to go with that. I mean, I'm getting to the point now after 6 months that I almost feel like praying every morning and every night for
yeah.
her and me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, for us together, it's almost selfish, you know. Mm-hmm. I just don't know, I guess, where to go with that or if you got any advice on where to go from there with annulment or anything.
Well, as someone who is not, you know, acquainted with the situation in detail, I can't offer you a huge amount of advice, but I'll do what I can. There's nothing wrong with continuing to pray for your marriage and continuing to do what you can to see if it can be saved. That could take a number of forms. Now you say she moved out, so you're living separately, and you know sometimes as people have lived separately for a time, the feelings can cool down a little bit, and a reconciliation may be possible. The fact that she was willing to do a retrovi with you and that it seemed to help at least a little bit, at least for a time, you know, that's a positive sign. It doesn't mean that she's not going to continue to want to pursue a divorce or live separately. You could, I mean, there is kind of an intermediate step between what you're doing now and actual divorce. That intermediate step is known as a formal separation, and they have those both in terms of civil law and in church, in terms of the church's canon law. Obviously, retrovi isn't the only possibility for seeing if a reconciliation, for actively working towards a reconciliation. There are other things that could play a role. I mean, different people in your family and friends may be able to offer advice to you and to her about how that could happen. Marital counseling, either with a priest or with a psychologist, those are possibilities as well. Ultimately, though, if she's determined to obtain a divorce, then the church acknowledges that divorce can be a legitimately used procedure for civil purposes, you know, to like deal with property arrangements and so forth like that. It doesn't mean that the union between you and her is not there before God. She may not think it's there before God, but that's not the church's understanding. If you wanted to pursue an annulment, then that's typically done after divorce. Most dioceses don't look at situations of people who haven't yet divorced. But if at some point in the future you do end up being divorced, then you could pursue an annulment and have the church look at your marital situation to see, were there factors that would have kept it from coming into existence validly at the time it was contracted? And if there were, then the church would issue what's known as a declaration of nullity. That's popularly called an annulment, but it would issue a declaration of nullity saying this, even though the parties may have entered this union in good conscience and neither one of them was doing anything wrong and they thought they were doing the right thing, for some reason, for one reason or another, it didn't result in a valid marriage, and so both parties are actually free to marry someone else. But that's something that could only be discerned by going through the process, at least based on the facts that you mentioned.
Okay, Scott?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
God bless you, brother. Thank you very much for the call and for the question.
And we'd ask the listeners to keep Scott and his wife and everybody in similar situations, because there's a lot of them today.
Yeah,
everybody in similar situations in prayer.
Let us go now to Christopher in Florida, listening on the TuneIn app. Christopher, your question for Jimmy. Hi, Christopher.
Hello. Hey, sorry about that. Thank you for taking my call. So I have a question for you. You hear all the time about these frauds and scams of supposedly big, massive healings and, you know, all those sorts of things. Some of it is authentic, some of it isn't, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to know what your take is on certain groups that that will go to different churches, Catholic churches, and do prayer groups where people go and they get healed and all this stuff. The other day, I was invited to a thing at the church with a friend of mine, the Catholic church. I show up, and there's a bunch of nuns from a local convent, and they're all praying on all kinds of people in the church, and then people walking out crying and all emotional and supposedly having healings and all these things. I didn't know how to feel about that. What do you guys think about that?
Well, so God does use prayer as an instrument through which people are healed, and sometimes that occurs in the context of a special prayer meeting for purposes of asking God for healing. Sometimes God gives people the spiritual gift of being able to perform healings. We read about that, for example, in St. Paul's letters, like 1 Corinthians. Having said that, you're also right. There are a lot of situations like this where people may think that they have received a miraculous healing when in fact they didn't. That's something that sometimes can be assessed subjectively. I mean, if I have a withered hand and I go and someone heals me and suddenly my hand works again that hasn't been working in years, I don't need to go to a doctor to say, yeah, I got healed.
Yeah.
On the other hand, if I have an internal disorder, I may have to go to a doctor and get an x-ray or a CAT scan to see has that really gotten better or not, no matter what I subjectively felt at the moment of the prayer service. So that's something that, you know, sometimes needs to be investigated. Is it, was there an actual healing? Because if there wasn't, you're going to need to continue medical treatment. Then, as you also mentioned, there are some situations where people will scam. We know, and sometimes the scammers even admitted it later. There was a Pentecostal evangelist back in the 50s and 60s and 70s named Marjo Gortner. His name, he was a child evangelist. He started preaching when he was like four at his parents' behest.
Yeah.
And he was named for Mary and Joseph, which is why his name is Marjo. But he would like marry people when he was 10 years old. You know, he'd perform weddings and stuff, and he would preach these revivals, and he would use stage magic to fake miracles. He had this powder that he would put on his forehead in the shape of a cross, and when he would start preaching, he'd perspire, you know, because Pentecostal preaching is frequently really fiery.
Yeah.
So he'd start perspiring, and the powder would turn red, and people would see this bloody cross appear on his forehead, and then he'd wipe it off. And we know about all these tricks he did because he told us. In the 1970s, he decided to stop being an evangelist, and he filmed his final evangelistic tour and did a documentary exposing himself as a charlatan.
Oh, that's awful, though. And but it's wonderful that he did the.
It's really is, you know, kind of weird in that way.
Yeah.
There are scams. There are times where people imagine something happened that didn't, and then there are times when it really happened. I can't tell you, Christopher, in terms of the situation you experienced. I can say that I went once to a similar event here in San Diego, and I tried to go in really open. I tried to go in just completely open and trusting to whatever God was going to do there and whatever might happen. And I tried to sincerely enter into the spirit of the service. And by the end of it, I felt this was so manipulative.
Oh.
And this was not, the evangelist was setting things up to generate these false psychological cures.
Oh, that's awful. Yeah.
And so I had a bad experience there, but God does do miracles, and there are other services where things are going to be done in accord with his will, and it works.
So we'll leave that there for you, Christopher. Thank you very, very much for that call and for that question. Let's go to Michael in Denver, Colorado, real quick, 10:60 a.m. He is listening on. Michael, can you give us your question kind of quick so Jimmy will have a chance to answer it before the top of the hour?
Taking my call. I have a question about John 6,
yep.
Verse 54, and trying to evangelize the true Catholic faith versus other Christian denominations.
Okay. What's the question? Because we're running short on time.
Their salvation, if that's true, if you only receive eternal life through the Eucharist, how do we view our Christian brothers who...
Okay, so this question comes up a lot. It's one of our most frequently asked questions here on Catholic Answers. I would guess I answer this once every month or two.
Okay.
The answer is that if you know God wants you to receive the Eucharist, then at some point in your life you need to. It is a means of grace. It does impart spiritual life to us. Having said that, God is, as St. Augustine is said to have remarked, we're bound by the sacraments, God is not. And so this is in the same category as things like having conscious faith in Christ. If you know that you should have conscious faith in Christ, then you need to have it in order to be saved. But babies don't know they need to have conscious faith in Christ. So they can be saved even though they don't know this through no fault of their own. So in the same way, if a person knows Jesus' will for the Eucharist and says, I don't care, I'm not doing that, then they're not going to be saved. But many people don't know Jesus' will regarding the Eucharist, and they can be saved as long as they otherwise respond to God's grace.
Thanks very much, Michael. Jimmy Akin, thank you very much.
My pleasure. And we had an item of business you said
I
we're
know.
Going to get to.
What is the topic this week on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World tomorrow?
The Mad Gasser of Mattoon.
And Mattoon is where?
In Illinois.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. So I didn't... Y'all just have to...
Fascinating story, and we've got a big twist on it. It happened back in the 1940s, but it's amazing.
All right. The Mad Gasser of Mattoon over at Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. Jimmy's book is The Bible is a Catholic Book. It's out now. Go get it. And coming up next, Mark Brumley to continue open forum here. If you're on the line, stay on the line. If you haven't called, 888-31-TRUTH.
Join us on air today on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers is a media ministry that serves Christ by explaining and defending the Catholic faith. We help Catholics grow in their faith, we bring former Catholics home, and we lead non-Catholics into the fullness of the truth. Our goal is to be the most trusted and accessible source for sharing, explaining, and defending the Catholic faith through as many media as possible, from personal contact to the most innovative means of mass communication. Have questions? We've got answers. Catholic Answers. Visit us today at Catholic.com or call us with your questions at 619-387-7200.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Would you like to become a Catholic Answers Live parish partner? We need you to help us spread the word at your local parish. We'll give you bumper stickers, window clings, flyers, everything you need to let your parish know about the best Catholic radio show on the air. We want you to partner with us. Email us at calpartners@catholic.com today and become a Catholic Answers parish partner.
Is the church wrong on contraception? In a culture that worships the pursuit of sexual pleasure, the Catholic Church's teaching on contraception can seem archaic and unintelligible. Its critics say it's outdated, theologically unfounded, and even harmful. And even faithful Catholics can have difficulty explaining this moral teaching. Catholic Answers is out to change all of that. That's why we've just released Trent Horn's dynamic new DVD, The Case Against Contraception. Using scripture, papal and magisterial teachings, natural law, and new insights provided by social science and medicine, Trent puts forward a compelling case for Catholic teachings with his trademark charity and persuasive graciousness. Be prepared to give a defense. Order your copy of The Case Against Contraception today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Author Mark McNeil spent years in the Oneness Pentecostal movement, praying in its lively services, zealously spreading its unconventional teachings, and rejecting mainstream Christianity as misguided. Then he left it all behind. All in the Name is the story of a man who believed he was among an elite group of believers who followed the true faith when so many others had strayed. But an inquisitive mind, careful study, and the action of the Holy Spirit finally led Mark out of Oneness Pentecostalism and into the Catholic Church. This is an inspiring conversion story you won't want to miss. It's a faith strengthener for Catholics and an intriguing challenge to those who deny the doctrine of the Trinity. Order your copy of All in the Name today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Tim Staples, Trent Horn, Cy Kellett, Chris Check, Carlo Broussard. Our On Fire lineup of speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker for your event, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Just as promised, the president of Ignatius Press here this hour to take your calls. Mark Brumley, also the author of Seven Deadly Sins of Apologetics. Hi, Mark. Oh, well, we'll get to Mark in a second. Let me give out the number. 888-318-7884 is the number. If you have a question about anything having to do with the Catholic faith, you are welcome to call this hour. 888-318-7884, the number. I'm sorry we had a momentary difficulty with Mark, but it does give me a chance to talk about something I wanted to mention to Mark. Is I see that on the Ignatius Press website, they have a new book out, and I'm not actually sure how new it is, on St. Jose, Boy Cristero Martyr. One of the most wonderful saints of the 20th century, and now they got a kid's book for him from the acclaimed Vision book series on the lives of saints for young people 9 to 15. So if you're looking for something for your youngin' to read as the new school year starts, maybe St. Jose, Boy Cristero Martyr would be the book for him. Do we have Mark back yet?
No. Yeah, I'm here. All right. Never left you guys. You guys left me.
Maybe I turned a knob or a dial or something that I wasn't. But I was just
that big button that said, get rid of Mark.
Oh, I wasn't supposed to push the eject button? Oh. Yeah. Oh, sorry. My bad.
Sorry about that.
I misunderstood that. So you heard me talking about this book you've got, St. Jose.
Just a little bit. Heard you talk a little bit about it.
Yeah. So, I mean, lots of kids heading back to school. They're going to need a book to read.
That is a great book.
Yeah, that's a good one. St. Jose is a hero of our president, Chris Check. He loves that guy.
Oh, I thought you meant President Trump.
Oh, I don't know if President Trump knows about St. Jose, the Cristero Martyr.
Maybe we'll send him a book, you know.
It wouldn't do him any harm. I'll tell you what, it never hurts to read about the saints. It doesn't hurt anybody.
There you go. Absolutely.
Yeah. So all is well there at Ignatius Press. You all are still the most important Catholic publisher in the quadrant.
Well, we are. We do our part. Let's put it that way. We just came out with Cardinal Seurat's new book, The Day Is Now Far Spent, and that's exciting, and it's, you know, something we want everybody to go out to the local Catholic bookstore to purchase, and if they can't get it there, they can get it online, various places, Ignatius.com, among others, and I think it's number one in Catholic books on Amazon, so there you are.
Hey, I'm really glad to hear you supporting your local Catholic bookstore, because we don't say that enough, but like the Amazons and those of the world can really crush local bookstores, and your local Catholic bookstore is a great resource for books, and also probably they've got gifts there and cards and holy cards and that kind of stuff. I'm glad you said that, Mark.
Yeah, well, we usually encourage people to first check out their local bookstores. You know, we're kind of distributist in that way, you know, Chesterton and Small is Beautiful and all that kind of stuff. And we think it's really good to support these local Catholic stores because they regard it really as an apostolate. They're serving the church. Oftentimes they don't make much money. Oftentimes they lose money. But they're doing this because they really want to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ and the teachings of the Catholic Church. And that's why these stores are there. So it's great when you go out and support them. Now, I know there are people say, well, I don't have a Catholic bookstore nearby, and that's fine. There are other ways you can get books, including online, but it's good to support the stores when we can.
888-318-7884, the number. It is open forum. Mark Brumley is our guest. A whole bunch of people are on the line. Are you ready, Mark?
I am ready if you are.
All right, let's start with Mike in Phoenix, Arizona, watching on YouTube Live. Mike, your question for Mark.
Hi, I just had a quick question. I was wondering if the Baltimore Catechism is still considered legitimate.
Sure, it's considered legitimate in that it's, you know, obviously the, an earlier expression in the form of a catechism of the Catholic faith, but there have been things that have changed in the church in terms of the church's liturgical practices and spiritual disciplines and things of that sort, and those won't be reflected in the Baltimore Catechism. There's also more contemporary issues that our society has to deal with that didn't exist in the 19th century, in 19th century America. So obviously, Baltimore Catechism is not going to address those issues. But in terms of the basic content of the catechism, it does not change. So yes, it's still worthwhile. There is a post-Vatican II, I think it was published in 67 or 68 edition of the Baltimore Catechism, which I used with my kids at times. Growing up, among other things, we use the Faith and Life series and a number of other resources. So that's available.
Okay, Mike.
Okay, thanks.
All right, thank you, Mike. Thanks very much for getting us started. Let's go to Sue in Columbus, Ohio, listening on AM 820 there in Columbus. Sue, your question for Mark.
Yeah, thank you for being available to answer questions and all. I was listening to the gal from Australia and the question about praying and to people that are already dead and how that all worked and how Jesus tells them what is relevant. And I've wondered, though, when I've been doing some study on this, but when you talk about praying for Mary's intercession, and then it makes my head spin because I'm thinking, well, then is Jesus telling her to somebody wants her to intercede to him? And, you know, it's kind of making my head spin. So I wondered if you could speak to that.
Let me just let Mark know. The question was about how saints might know that someone is praying for their help. And Jimmy went through several options, including one that God would let them know. So I right. I'm taking the question to be, okay, so you might pray to Mary to ask her intercession. And so is God letting Mary know to pray for that person to God? Is that kind of the cycle you're concerned with, Sue?
Okay. Seems like you're asking Mary, but by virtue of asking her, you're asking Jesus to tell her that
someone's asking for their prayers. Yeah. Okay, Mark.
Yeah, and what I'd say, that's a good question. I'd say this, we always have to be careful when we talk about things in the next life, things that have to do with eternity and the presence of God, how God does things in eternity. We must be careful when we do that because we are drawing on language from this life, and we know how things work in this life. And sometimes, in order to kind of get at this mysterious life of the age to come, we have to use lots of different things from this life, and we have to understand that they have a kind of figurative dimension. So the idea is, okay, God knows everything. The saints in heaven find out what's going on earth through God. So God is telling them what they need to know so that they can then intercede with God on our behalf through Jesus. And that sounds like a complex process, but we should stop and think about the fact that in this world, in this life, God has established the world in such a way that we can learn things, we can know things about one another and our needs. And so just as you can learn from me that I have a need, I do right now, like everybody be praying for my mom who's coming towards the end of her life, you know, so I ask people to pray for her. Well, how do they find out? I tell them. Okay, so God has established in the natural order of the world a way by which we can become aware of one another's needs. And then once we're aware of those needs, we can approach God, even though God has made it possible in this world. He's the one who's made possible in this world our ability to know one another's needs. Nevertheless, we can then, once we know, we can approach God and ask Him to intervene, and we can pray for one another. Well, similarly, God has made it possible. How that happens, I don't know exactly, but God has made it possible for the saints in heaven to know the needs of people on earth. And however that happens, whether there's a, I'm being a little facetious here, a divine telephone or divine radio service or divine internet, whatever the analogy we want to use is, that represents the way by which people in God's presence, in communion with God, come to know about the needs of people on earth. Whatever that means is, they come to know it, and they can then, on that basis, pray for us. That's what we call, you know, the communion of saints, or the intercession of the saints. So we don't want to press the point too much to make it sound like heaven is one big party line where everybody gets on and you know, God has set up the party line or whatever. But we do have, just as in this life, God allows us to come to know one another's needs and concerns. So in the next life, God allows the saints in heaven to come to know the needs and concerns of people on earth so that they can pray through Jesus in the Spirit for their brothers and sisters on earth. Does that help?
Yeah, and I'm thinking in terms of this earth, and that's not necessarily how it's going to be.
I like the idea of a divine internet, though. I'm glad that idea was introduced into the whole conversation.
I thought you'd prefer a divine radio network, but...
I don't want to work. I'm not looking forward to working on the other side.
There you go.
I'm looking forward to eating cookies, divine cookies, and being in the presence of the Lord. Sue, thanks very much. But the reason there were cookies on my mind is because Erica's here. Mark, you know Erica Olson here.
Hi.
Yeah. Hi, Erica. How you doing?
Good. Yeah, Mark was with us at our conference.
2 years
ago.
2 years ago.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. So I'm here to invite everyone to the conference. Mark, are you coming?
I wanted to come, but I'm doing a diocesan event up here in Northern California that time.
All right, I'll give you a pass.
Sorry.
But anybody who doesn't,
well, there's very few things more noble than being at the service of the local church.
That's true.
You should put yourself at the
That's
service.
True.
It's very true. But if you're not, and you don't have anything to do on the weekend of September 26th.
Wow, 29. You're really selling this. If you have nothing better to do,
we're having a national conference. If your agenda is open, you should come to our conference. It's going to be really awesome. And I can't say enough great things about it. There's only less than 3 weeks left.
Yeah.
2.5 weeks left
and
for you to get your tickets.
And far fewer than 200 tickets available. So.
Yes, fewer than 200 tickets available. And it's just around the corner. So if you are thinking about coming, you need to buy your tickets because I will close registration as well prior to conference date. So I usually do that about a week before. So really, you only have a week and a half to get your tickets, everyone.
Uh-oh.
You'll want to do that. And everybody who comes. Oh, I was going to talk about your cookie.
First, I was going to give the address because
okay,
you got to give it out.
It.
Catholic
go.
Answers. I mean, if you're inviting people, they got to know how to get there. CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Yes.
CatholicAnswersConference.com. And I'm sorry. I see you brought the cookie to do the big cookie
reveal.
I did
bring a cookie. Look,
but I did it with Carlo yesterday.
Can you see it?
I should. That's the cookie.
If you're on Facebook or YouTube,
Thomas will get you on there in a second.
Do you got it on there, Thomas?
That's what we call cookie cam.
This is Cy Kellett
in
the shape
of
a cookie.
Or maybe it's really actually a cookie in the shape of Cy Kellett. I mean, it's.
This is true.
Because Cy Kellett is already in the shape of a cookie.
That's a pretty uncanny. They did a really great job in getting you.
Somebody told me it looks like Bob Vila. Which is, I think that's a promotion. I'm happy to look like Bob Vila. But,
that's totally true, actually, a little bit.
I'm a cookie.
That's very true. But if you come, you get this awesome cookie souvenir to either save for the rest of your life.
or just
and
eat
put
it
on a shelf, or just eat it, just,
or give it to me,
know,
and I'll eat it.
Eat size face.
So CatholicAnswersCookie.com. Well, no, it's CatholicAnswersConference.com.
You only have, again, a week and a half left to get your tickets. We have a great lineup. All of our apologists, Tim, Jimmy, Trent, Carlo, and then we have Monsignor Eugene Morris, Father David McConey, Rod Bennett, and Bishop Frank Cajano is coming. Father Paul Check will be there. Chris Check will be there, just walking around. Who else? So many people. Father Hugh Barber will be there.
Tell you guys, yep. I was going to be there, but because I got asked to be it. The Catechetical Conference in Santa Rosa, you know, it's my local church, kind of felt like that should be my priority, but I would have been there, and I'm going to tell you guys, it's going to be a great conference. All the people listening, you know, it looks at how the early church was Catholic, and there's a lot of controversy there. People question that, you know, they have this idea that the early church was something else, and then later on it became Catholic, but you got first-rate apologists and scholars showing how no, there's continuity going back all the way back to Jesus. So.
Yeah, that's true. You're going to get such a great defense of your faith, and then you're going to have a great time with 800 of your best Catholic friends.
1,000.
That's right.
CatholicAnswersConference.com.
It's common for atheists to object to belief in God because it can't be proven false by empirical observation. But this objection fails because the principle it assumes, called the verification principle, is self-refuting. It states, a belief is true or false if and only if it can be verified or falsified by sense experience. Like the statement, it's snowing outside, which can prove true or false by looking out the window. But this principle is problematic because the principle itself can't be proven true or false by sense experience. Where in the universe is the truth value of this belief to be found? Can we see it under a microscope? The absurdity of these questions reveal that the principle itself cannot be proven true or false by sense experience, and thus is self-refuting. For this reason, the objection fails. I'm Carlo Broussard with the Ready Reason for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Ever wonder about the power of prayer? St. John Chrysostom states that prayer in converse with God is a supreme good. It is a partnership and union with God. As the eyes of the body are enlightened when they see light, so our spirit, when it is intent on God through prayer, is illumined by His infinite light. Let God's infinite light be your guiding light. Ask Him to guide you daily in your prayer, work, recreation, home life with family, and your friendships.
Mark Brumley, our guest. That's a pretty good day when you have Jimmy Akin followed by Mark Brumley. You're doing pretty good. I feel like we're doing pretty good here, Nick. Why am I getting no approval? Yeah, that's what I wanted, Nick. I wanted you to nod your head and say, yes, that's pretty good. 888-318-7884 is the number. Mark Brumley is president of Ignatius Press, and you can visit them at ignatius.com. They make movies. They do books and CDs and DVDs. They're all kinds of wonderful things to bring you closer to Jesus and His church. So go over there and visit them. Up next is Stephen calling from Washington, D.C., and I assume he's listening on Guadalupe Radio because that's the station in Washington, D.C., but I'll just go with that assumption. Stephen, your question for Mark Brumley.
Hey, how you doing? I'm actually using the app right now, but my question has to do with the rosary, the way that I've been praying the rosary recently, and I was just wondering if it's okay to do or if it's like heretical, something like that. So what I've been doing is kind of similar to the Eastern practice of hesychasm, where I'll be, for each Hail Mary, I'll take a deep breath in for the first part, and then a deep breath, and then breathe out for like the second half of the prayer. So like it's one.
Yes. Okay.
Hail Mary, and yeah.
So you're wondering if you're now a heretic for doing that?
Present.
Oh my goodness! Cut him off. Get him off the. Get him off the air. He's going to corrupt the whole country. Everybody's going to start praying the rosary the way he does.
You cannot pray a Latin prayer like the rosary as using an Eastern method like hesychasm, right?
Are you serious?
Somewhat facetious.
Are you really?
I do not believe that Stephen is a heretic.
You're just saying it's just spiritually inappropriate. Is that what you're trying to imply?
I am not. I'm actually thinking it's very beautiful what he's doing.
No, what he is doing is very beautiful, and it's a perfectly legitimate way to pray the rosary. I think it's kind of neat. I often pray the rosary when I'm driving in traffic, so I probably might not try that there. But in other contexts, that's certainly something to try. So I think I might give it a try myself.
How's that?
Stephen, I think that's great.
Okay, Stephen?
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Very good.
Yeah.
God bless you. Yeah, pray that rosary. Pray. That's the thing. Pray the rosary. Anonymous is up next. Anonymous in an anonymous location. Your question for Mark Brumley.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I have a pretty quick question. I'm teaching first grade CCD, and we start on Sunday, and I want to try to teach them a little bit about the Mass, and I wondered if it would be okay to teach them the response to the Lord be with you by having them say, and with your spirit, just as a greeting every morning, or if that's something that's only allowed for the priest to do.
No, it's perfectly legitimate. I would explain to them what you're doing and why you're doing it so that it'll help them make the connection with Mass, but it's perfectly legitimate to do.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Hey, don't go anywhere, Anonymous, because...
Oh, don't go... Okay.
No, you're a CCD teacher, which makes you one of our heroes here. You are doing the hard work passing on. So I want to send you a free copy of Jimmy Akin's new book, The Bible is a Catholic Book. In order to do that, you will have to be not anonymous to Marie, but that's up to you. You want to hang on and she'll get...
I will be not anonymous to get that great book. Yes, thank you.
Yes, God bless you for teaching CCD, and God bless everybody who is back to teaching CCD. I don't know, Catechetical Sunday, is that this Sunday? Or
I think it's this.
I am not sure.
Because then we get the catechists get blessed at church and all that, and you...
I think it's actually September 15th, but I may be wrong about that.
September 15th. All right, well, it's coming up in any case, and I just wanted to take the opportunity to say thank you for doing that great work and send you a little something free. Appreciate it, Anonymous.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, well, yeah, and you too. Mark, up next, George in Santa Rosa, California. So this could possibly be a neighbor of yours. I don't know, but George, your question.
Well,
for Mark.
I live about an hour away from Santa Rosa, but that's okay.
Well, thank you, Mark, and thank you, Sai, for taking my question. I've been on your show before, and I am not a Catholic. I am a Protestant. Okay, so my question has to do with the episcopacy, so-called bishops and archbishops. They, in the United States and pretty much every country in the world, they are appointed by the Pope in Rome. So you have at least two problems. So these men who are in charge of these dioceses and archdioceses in America and in the other country are appointed by a foreign entity, and I would argue a hostile foreign entity. Second, a number of these men were not born in America. For example, we have several prelates in the United States, archbishops and archbishops, who were born in Mexico. When it comes to the question of whatever euphemism you want to call it, the Latino Catholic invasion or whatever, they have a serious conflict of interest.
All right. So what would you like Mark to answer for you? I see how you're setting it up, but what's the question for Mark?
How can we possibly correct this situation? It's simply a matter of, these prelates are a threat to our national security.
Okay, fair enough. I'm trying to think. I think we only have one bishop in the U.S. born in Mexico. He is a wonderful bishop. He's the Archbishop of Los Angeles, as a matter of fact. Mark, what are we going to do about the fact that we Catholics have popes, the Pope appoints the bishops, and it appears that many of them have Latino last names? How can we fix that situation?
Doesn't seem like a situation needs fixing. The Catholic Church appoints bishops. The Pope appoints bishops on the basis of what, in his judgment, is the best interest of the Catholic Church as a church. Of course, he's got to take into consideration where those bishops are going to be leading, and that means he has to be mindful of the countries in which those bishops will reside. But But his interest is not and shouldn't be primarily what's in the best interest, politically speaking, of any given country that he's appointing bishops for. His interest, and I certainly wouldn't want it to be that, his interest is what's in the best interest of the Catholic Church. So what's in the best interest of the mission of the Church that Christ has given to the Church? Now, that doesn't make popes infallible about their episcopal appointments. They can sometimes make mistakes or appoint people that are not good bishops or whatever. But their business is not primarily what's of interest to the, what's in the political interest of the country to which they are appointing bishops. So that's the first point. Second point, with respect to a conflict of interest I'm not quite sure I see the concept, unless the implication is that people who have a Hispanic background are ipso facto disloyal to the country. I just would say I don't see any evidence of that, nor do I have any reason to suppose that a Latino bishop is going to be disloyal to America any more than an Irish bishop or a German bishop or whatever. So I don't find the objection convincing.
Fair enough. Archbishop Gomez, by the way, I didn't get his name in before, but Archbishop Gomez, the Archbishop of Los Angeles, born in Mexico. I almost feel like we should confess that we love one another as Catholics, and whether you're Mexican or Irish or Italian,
absolutely,
that what we do as Catholics is we love one another. So
exactly,
yeah.
These are, and national borders are important, but they're not all important. They're
right,
not more important than the unity of the Catholic Church.
And we certainly love Archbishop Gomez. So I'll thank you for the call and for the opportunity to get to say we love each other as Catholics. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Mark Brumley right after this.
Your questions, Catholic answers, live.
In his new audio presentation, The Very First Fathers, apologist Jimmy Akin takes you on a tour of the earliest Christian writings outside the New Testament, from the most famous figures and most notable works to those lesser known but no less important. This pivotal time in the development of the early church is revealed in fascinating detail. Jimmy shows how, even in the first century after the resurrection, it was necessary to defend and explain truths that are still under attack today, such as the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist and the perpetual virginity of Mary. The Very First Fathers is a compelling look at the dawn of the Christian age and edifying listening for anyone who wants to understand and defend the full truth of Catholicism. Order your copy of The Very First Fathers today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
A generation ago, Christian parents didn't have to worry about how to explain transgenderism to their 9-year-old children or help their teenager deal with mockery at school for believing in traditional marriage. But today, as our culture decays, we have to know how to talk to our children about these issues. In Made This Way, How to Prepare Kids to Face Today's Tough Moral Issues, Layla Miller and Trent Horn give parents the crucial tools and techniques to form children with the understanding they need, appropriate to their age and maturity level, to meet the world's challenges. If we're not teaching our children how to understand tough moral issues, then the world will. Read Made This Way and learn how to give your kids a firm foundation on which to build a life of moral clarity and happiness. Order your copy of Made This Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000 or logging onto the shop at Catholic.com.
Catholic organizations are doing amazing things in this world. We want to hear your take on tomorrow's Take Two with Jerry and Debbie. Now let's get back to Cy Kellett and Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We have two archbishops in California, and I'm as a Southern Californian, I'm not saying Archbishop Gomez is better than yours up there in Northern California, Corleone.
Well, I was going to mention him a little bit, but I didn't want to get into a... Anyway, go ahead.
No, sorry. I mean, I think it's generally acknowledged that our archbishop is better than your archbishop. That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying that anything negative I'm just saying that Archbishop Gomez is...
I somehow... I somehow think that that's sort of not like an appropriate thing to say.
I'm only kidding, because Archbishop Corleone is actually a San Diegan, and we love him here, and he's going on a cruise with us.
That's right.
In June. Go. So, well, you think I'm being...
I don't know. He may not be going now.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I apologize for that. We love our... Of course we love Archbishop Corleone.
But I would like to... Can I say a little something about the previous call? Sort of... just the caller who isn't here to defend himself. But I mean, I do think we need to be very careful when we talk about different ethnic and cultural groups in the United States. So the Catholic Church is, as I said, a big community. We're a big church. We have law, you know, we're universal. We're not confined to this particular ethnic group or that particular ethnic group or whatever. And also, you know, there are attitudes in American society that looks upon people who are, you know, looks at people who are different from a different cultural background and makes a generalization about those kinds of folks. And we have to watch that. That is I mean, at its root, that's kind of a racist attitude. And that's not something that we want to be supportive of. Even apart from questions about immigration and culturation, those are all important political things. The church has something to say about them. The church isn't primarily a political entity, so you know we're trying to take the moral teaching of Jesus and apply it to concrete situations. And sometimes, you know, Christians who are committed to the same principles will disagree about the best way to implement those principles. But whatever our agreements, disagreements on questions of immigration and culturation, we should not disagree as followers of Jesus that all people about any ethnic group or cultural group or racial group is made in the image and likeness of God and needs to be valued as someone with an inherent dignity. So we have to be careful about this kind of talk.
Thank you, Mark. I appreciate that you saying that because it is serious business. But we just love each other. That's what the Catholic Church does. And our caller said he wasn't Catholic, but it's also the case that you know, Catholics, we get this way in house as well. It's not just from exterior criticism. And if you're not prepared to love everybody, if you're not prepared to love all your brothers and sisters in the Catholic Church, your problem's with Jesus, not with anybody else.
Right. Yeah.
Let's go to John in South Dakota, listening on the great Real Presence Radio up there in South Dakota. John, delighted to have your call. Your question for Mark Brumley. And you know what, Mark? I mean, John up there. And let me give out the phone number before I do that, though, because I have made a mistake and not given out the phone number for a long time. So 888-318-7884 is the number, 888-318-7884. Mark Brumley is our guest, and I'm sorry I made you wait. John in South Dakota, go ahead with your question.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. My question has to do with the homily. I went to Mass a few months ago, and I was waiting for the homily and after the gospel. And after the gospel, the priest didn't address the gospel. He went off into a rant about football players kneeling and how football players, no one's, you know, the only person we kneel for is Christ. I mean, he really went on. It was offensive to me. I didn't know what to do. I couldn't just sit there. I got up, I genuflected, I made a sign of the cross, I left Mass. My question is, what is the appropriate response when you go to Mass and instead of, you know, receiving instruction on my Catholic faith, I'm getting political stuff? I didn't know how else to respond.
Okay, Mark, what do you say?
Well, it's good question. I've been in the situation myself where I've been at Mass and heard things in a homily, not just that were challenging, but which I thought were inappropriate. Doesn't usually happen in my parish, but I've been to churches where that does happen. And so it poses a challenge. So then I think what you have to do is you pray for the person. If he's saying something that you regard as inappropriate or offensive, you pray for that person. If it's a priest or a deacon in a homily, pray for them. And then you just try to offer up the suffering that's come as a result of this offensive action offered up with the Eucharist. I think it's certainly appropriate in a respectful way after Mass, you know, to approach the homilist and say, you know, you said this, Father, or you said this, Deacon. I don't understand that, or I don't agree with it, or I don't think it was appropriate. Now, we have to understand sometimes in teaching the teaching of the church or proclaiming the gospel, there are going to be things in that teaching or in that message that have political implications or political application. They're not primarily political teaching. The church isn't a political society or a political action committee. But there can be things in the teaching of Jesus. There are things in the teaching of Jesus that will have political implications. So we want to be discerning and we want to be receptive to whatever the church has to offer us in terms of the gospel, even when it has political implications, and try to form our faith and our conscience accordingly. But we're going to have to also recognize, and this is where it's really important for the homilist to understand, that on many, many issues, there are different, legitimately different ways in which Catholics can approach those issues, as I said earlier, all the while affirming and holding to the same spiritual teaching or the same theological or moral teaching. About a lot of these issues, there are differences of opinion. You have certainly a legitimate difference of opinion on how you, what you think about sports figures kneeling or not kneeling, praying or not praying, or doing all these kinds of things. And so it's would, in my opinion, this is my opinion, it would be imprudent to bring that up in a homily if you were to address it in such a way as to give the impression to the congregation that everybody has to agree with the priest or the deacon in the homily and his particular view of the matter. And that's a problem. So I say, this is how I handle it. I try to prayerfully, when something is said I think is inappropriate or offensive, I pray for the priest or deacon involved. And if I can do so respectfully afterward, I express my disagreement. You may not change his mind, but at the very least, you help him see that there are people in the congregation who can respond in a respectful way who disagree with them.
What do you think, John?
I thank you very much. That is what I did. You know, I have a relationship with the priest. He's a good guy. He's a spiritual man. And, you know, I don't know if we came to any understanding afterwards of that. I had a kind of a bad phone call with him. He told me, well, if I felt that way, I didn't have to come to Mass at his parish anymore. Well, he called me back within 2 or 3 minutes and backed off of that situation. And it's important to me because I was away from the church for like 35,
right,
for 40 years. And,
right.
Well, you know, I have to say, priests get, it's crazy the amount of pressure they get sometimes. I know that here, Mark, and maybe you get it as well in your ministry, people will want us to take a political position. And sometimes be mad at us, like, how can you not be speaking up about this or that? And I mean, we try to speak very clearly on moral issues, but politically, you are free. And also, we don't have any special charism to know what's true politically or not, nor does your priest, nor does your bishop. The church has teachings, and we want you to have those. But I do think it's easy to get pressured sometimes into say something about this, say something about that, and forgetting, well, that's not our role as
that's
Catholic
right.
answers, or that's not a priest's right. role to do that.
Right. That's right. There's clear ethical teaching, and some things obviously violate that teaching that needs to be addressed, and it can have political implications, and those things need to be addressed. But then you move down a step or two, and you have to say, well, yes, there are differences of opinion among conscientious, committed Catholics.
Right.
That doesn't mean, by the way, sometimes this is taken to be a kind of political relativism, which imply, you know, here it say, well, there is no Catholic position on this. Well, that's true in the sense that the church doesn't endorse or oppose particular candidates for office, and nor does the church, as the church, establish particular pieces of legislation and things of that sort. the fact that reasonable Catholics can differ about a thing doesn't mean that there's no right position. It could be that one side or another in this debate, which there's reasonable grounds for disagreement, is correct or more correct than the other side. It's just that that's not evident simply from the fact that the people involved are committed Catholics, that they're committed to Catholic principles, Catholic teachings. You know, this Catholic may support, I'll be, you know, a little facetious or flip, you know, this school lunch program, that Catholic over there may oppose that, think it's a bad idea and prefer a different approach to dealing with that particular issue. That doesn't mean that simply because both of them are bringing their Catholic faith to bear on the issues that of the day, that the church is irrelevant because there are different positions taken by Catholics. Nor does it mean that there isn't necessarily a right position. It's just that it's not immediately evident from the principles themselves. And that's kind of hard for people, especially in a very politicized environment such as we're in today, where people want to smuggle in, as it were, some kind of authority to say, you got to have to agree with me politically on this issue.
Right.
And the church is a big authority.
Yeah. But hearing John, I guess why I want to dwell on this for a moment is that John's away from the church for 25 years. Yes. All of us who have or who speak for the church, whether it's as a little lay apostle like us, or whether it's someone with authority like a priest or a bishop, we should not do anything that drives a good Christian away from the sacraments because we wanted to make a political point, or because we wanted to, have our opinion respected. That's a misprioritization.
Right. And of course, you know, we don't want to leave the impression that priests or deacons, when they're giving homilies, can never say anything that someone somewhere might find offensive.
No.
Because they're, you know, just teaching the gospel, there are going to be some people who are offended.
Right.
Nevertheless, you don't set out to offend, and especially when you're getting into the area of politics, or this wasn't even really so much a political thing, it was talking about more of a cultural phenomena. When you get into that area, you need to preface, if you're going to bring it up at all, and it's probably a bad idea to bring it up, but if you're going to bring it up at all, you need to preface it and say, you know, this is my opinion. I recognize people might disagree with this, but here's my thinking on it, you know, so that gives people in the congregation room to say, well, you know, you raised a good point. I don't agree with you still, but I respect you and the way that you brought it up. And that tends to contribute to a more healthy Catholic environment, rather than this constant politicization, characterization of people who disagree with us as, you know, sellouts or wicked or whatever.
Yeah. John, don't leave the church over it, though, all right?
Oh, I won't. I appreciate the work that you people do.
Well, you really honor us with your call, John. Welcome home. Glad you're back. Glad to hear nothing's going to shake you from that. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Mark Brumley right after this.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
What's stopping you from becoming a Catholic?
Why can't women become priests?
I don't understand why I have to earn salvation.
How is it possible that God created everything?
Why do I need to confess my sins to
a
priest?
Why is the Catholic Church so unwilling to
the Catholic Church is too rich.
Catholics worship Mary and are committed.
As far as I'm concerned, all religions are equal.
You are called to communion with Dr. David Anders. Tonight, 11 p.m. Eastern, on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
A lot of people think that street evangelization involves yelling out of a bullhorn telling people that they're going to hell. Not so with St. Paul's Street Evangelization. Our methods are non-confrontational and effective. We simply offer information on the Catholic faith, along with rosaries, miraculous medals, and prayer. Pope Francis wrote about how beautiful it is to see street preachers joyfully bringing Jesus to every corner of the earth. Street evangelization is fun and fruitful. Join us today at streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Mark Brumley is our guest. Mark is president of Ignatius Press. You can find out all about them at Ignatius.com. Open forum means anybody can call with any question at all, whether you're Catholic or not, 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. Let us go now to Michael in Maryland. Michael, your question for Mark Brumley.
Hi, gentlemen. I was born and raised Catholic, and one of the things I struggle most with is understanding the role of celebrating the saints and the feast days in my life. I feel generally that that effort can be put to reading the Bible and being more involved in my faith directly with God. And intellectually, I understand and accept the ability for the saints to intercede for us. But how much emphasis are we supposed to put on the saints' lives as opposed to directly looking at the Bible and Jesus?
Wow, that's a good question. I'm going to give you a kind of a mundane answer. We have to be balanced here. You know, the purpose of the saints is to glorify God. That's why they exist. You know, God makes saints to express his goodness, his love, which we would say is God's glory. So if we are celebrating saints' feast days and other aspects of the lives of saints in ways that glorify God, point people to Jesus, that's doing it the right way. If we do these things in a way that takes from or is seen as a rivalry towards Jesus, and I don't really know of Catholics who do that, but I can understand in theory I could see how that might happen, but just my experience of the church today is the Catholics who tend to emphasize saints' feast days don't usually see the saints as rivals with Jesus, but we have to make sure that, in fact, that we are understanding the saints, the lives of the saints, the role of the saints in the church as sort of elder brothers and sisters in Christ, disciples who follow the Lord and provide good examples for us and who are present now with the Lord and eager to support the ongoing work of the church through their intercessory prayer. So I think keeping that in mind, learning more about how Jesus manifests himself through this particular saint, you know, one way of thinking of the saints is they're sort of the multifaceted expression of the life of Jesus lived in different times, different places by different people. And so if we're looking at the saints correctly, they should be bringing us closer to Jesus. What do you think about that, Michael?
I think intellectually I accept that, and I understand the role of kind of these guides in our life. For example, Mother Teresa of Calcutta and her sacrifice, right, and is a great role model and guides us. Sometimes I feel, however, we have, as Catholics, almost an overemphasis of feast days as opposed to the Eucharist. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not a rejection of the saints. It's the emphasis.
Well, I can only say that I can understand that as a concept. I don't encounter it in my own life or in my parish life and so on. So it's a little bit of an abstraction for me. I do know that the closer you get to the saints, where you feel like they're part of your spiritual family, you're part of theirs, it's probably going to be something that's going to diminish that sense of overemphasis. I remember many years ago, a Baptist friend of mine, we were talking about the saints, and he didn't believe in the intercession of the saints, but I said, you know, I'll bet you there have been times when you're studying the Bible or something like that, but studying St. Paul, you wish that St. Paul could be there to help explain himself. And he says, yeah, that's true. And I said, you ever think about asking St. Paul, even a moment of frustration, Paul, what are you talking about here? And he said, you know, I wouldn't generally acknowledge this to my Baptist brethren, but yes, I have. I've been in exactly that situation. I said, well, that kind of shows you a little bit on an emotional level, on a spiritual emotional level, how Catholics see the intercession of the saints. So I think Catholics better integrating the saints into their own spiritual lives and their discipleship with Jesus should diminish that problem where it exists. But That's just my take on it.
All right, Michael.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very, very much for the call. We go now to Joshua in Norman, Oklahoma, listening on the Oklahoma Catholic Broadcasting Network. Joshua, your question for Mark Brumley.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, Joshua.
Hi. Good evening. I'm reading a book about the history of Vatican II, and the more I read about Vatican II and the Novus Ordo, I'd like to ask the question, would it be fair to describe the new Mass as a Protestantized Mass?
My view is no. I don't think it's fair to call it that. I know there are people who, for a variety of reasons, dislike or object to various aspects of the, you know, the Missal of 1970. And we need to make a distinction. That's that, you know, the Missal of 1970 is not something that the Second Vatican Council itself promulgated, but that came some years later. And there are all kinds of questions we can raise about how the new so-called new Mass is promulgated, how it's celebrated in any particular parish, and so on. But I don't think the rite itself is accurately described as a Protestantized version of the Mass. All the essential elements of Catholic teaching are present in it. So I don't, and nothing that's distinctively Protestant is in it. So I from my perspective, I don't see it as being Protestantized.
Joshua?
Oh, thank you so much.
Okay. All right. Fair enough.
Good.
Up next, Dylan. Don't have a location for you, Dylan, but we're glad you're here. Your question, please, for Mark Brumley.
Oh, hey there.
Hey there.
Can you hear me?
We can, Dylan. Your question.
Cool. Yes. So I'm very interested in the Catholic faith, and my wife isn't quite in the same place as I. And so one thing that she mentioned briefly while we're talking about it is that essentially what she was saying is that if we believe the core and basic doctrines like the Incarnation, the Trinity, hypostatic union, stuff like that, then it really doesn't matter what you like, what denomination you belong to, because as long as you're doing the things like Lord's Supper or baptism, then it's fully valid to the same extent as it would be in the Catholic Church. And I was just wondering, to what degree is that true? To what degree is that not true? Because if you look at different denominations, like we're currently Baptist, they teach that baptism is symbolic, you know? So, and then that the Lord's Supper is symbolic as well. But if you look at the Catholic Church, it's different. So what do you think about that?
Okay.
Well, I think I'm a Catholic, so I believe Jesus Christ established the church. The church that he established is the Catholic Church. There are other churches and ecclesial communities that share elements of that Catholic faith, more or less. And there are these other communities that have things that I think depart from what Christ gave to his church and intends for his church. So for me, these things are not minor or secondary. I think they're important because they came from Jesus, and I want everything that Jesus wants. So if Jesus established these things, I understand Baptists don't believe that Jesus established the Catholic Church. That's why they're Baptists. But as a Catholic, I believe he does. That's why I'm a Catholic. So I'm going to say these are not unimportant things. Now, can they be exaggerated so we lose to such a degree that we lose sight of what we have in common? Sure, they can be, but they're not. It's not a minor thing whether or not Jesus established the Eucharist and established a priesthood and gave us sacraments, and whether he intends us to baptize infants or not, whether he guides his church through leaders, bishops, and a pope. And these are not secondary questions; they're important questions. And Christians of goodwill, often come down on different sides of that, but I'm not going to tell you they're not important questions. They're very important questions, and if And most Baptists regard them as important questions. If they didn't regard them as important questions, they would teach these things as at least optional or at least legitimate different ways of expressing Christianity. Most Baptists don't do that. They say, no, they may be nice about it and ecumenical, but they're going to say, no, we don't believe this. We don't believe in infant baptism. We don't believe in the real presence of Jesus in the Eucharist. We don't believe that there is an authority structure that unites the whole church. So these are important points, and we have to talk about them, pray about them, and come to settled Christian convictions about where the truth lies.
And Dylan, we will have to leave it there. Thank you very, very much for the call. Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press, thanks for doing a great hour with us. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Glad to be with you.
And again, we'll remind folks, pray for Mark's mom, who is in the last stages of her life, and pray for Mark and their whole family. Tomorrow, we're going to have a very, very serious discussion about transgenderism and the whole transgender movement. I really hope you'll join us for that tomorrow, God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.